Army back during Desert Storm. But even then, he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we are more when you get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Welcome to Foo Bar, One Nation Under Foo. I am your host, the plain, the humble, the black-clad man with a single silver button, Ordy Packard. Foo is out doing family shit for the rest of the year and holidays and all that stuff, so I called up the matriarch of misfit politics, Jen Holstem, and see if she could join me. Jen, how you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. How are you? Happy belated Thanksgiving.
Happy belated Thanksgiving. It's been, it was really, really good. How was yours?
Fantastic.
It
was so nice. We just my dad's whole side of the family, we always do Thanksgiving with them. Christmas we spend with my mom's family, and Thanksgiving we spend with my dad's family, and everybody came over to my mom's house, and we had, you know, 8 kiddos and a bunch of adults making cocktails, and dad smoked a turkey on the green egg and copious amounts of mashed potatoes and all that good stuff, and you know, football on TV. So it was awesome.
You know, I've been seeing that green egg in a lot of food Twitter photos lately. It's popping up.
Man, it is. Like, my dad, you know, he looked into a lot of things. He has a regular grill too, but he looked into a lot of things, and, you know, we have an old school smoker that my grandpa built, that, you know, we use at one of our family places that's for the brisket and the things like that. And it's that old tried and true, but you know, my dad wanted something more efficient, instead of going with a full on smoker. And so he looked into that and the green egg came up and he just watched a million videos and reviews on it and all of that, and decided to bite the bullet and put it in. And man, it has been amazing. All the meats, all the tenderloins and the turkeys and the, you know, things that you don't even normally like go, oh yeah, I want that. They all taste better on the, I mean, he smokes olives and pickles and all kinds of things like that, that cold smokes cheese. Yeah, we just, damn. He gets a hell of a lot of use out of it.
I may have to invest. I've been thinking about it and I may have to pull the trigger on one of those.
Let me tell you about a smoked dirty martini, sir.
Ooh. You have my curiosity. Now you have my attention.
Yeah. I also do a smoked pickle martini. We get the liqueurs pickles. He cold smokes some. We save the juice. They like sit in that juice. And then you use that juice for your martini. And it's got this rich smoky flavor. It's so freaking amazing. So yeah, it's what he saw one YouTube video about it, tried about 20 different things. Pickled okra, he smokes that. It's one of the most amazing things in the world. It's ridiculous. Black olives, green olives, cheese, like I said, it's just nuts. So anyways, one of the things he started doing a couple years ago, he finally decided to try the turkey on it. And it is so moist. It is so smoky, but it's not that smokehouse smoke. Like, you know, you can buy a smoked turkey or a smoked turkey breast and it's like got that real distinct flavor. This is more of a infused kind of, you know, it just came fresh cooked. So
it's got smoke ring on it and that's about it. And once you get, you know, it, right.
But it really is. It really does permeate throughout the meat in a way that we didn't think would happen. And it keeps everything juicy. And anyways, it's just amazing. So that's our deal now.
Yeah. It's a good hobby to have.
For sure. Well, I'm just glad that I live nearby him because I get to try out all of his, you know, all of his little endeavors where he goes, well, I'm going to try this now. Maybe I'll do that. And I'm like, guinea pig. Right. Who do you need to taste? And that's what we do a lot. We go over there and we taste, try all his stuff until he perfects it. And we get a ton of free food.
What's your experiment this week? I was going to try some goat cheese. Yeah, I'll be right over.
Yeah. I mean, seriously, it's like constant. It's also the thing that like pork tenderloins are so easy and they don't take any time at all. So he always has like two or three in the freezer and they thaw pretty quickly. So anytime that it's kind of like, oh crud, what do we do now? Gosh, okay, we just got back from a baseball game, but like, we don't want to like order in, but we want to cook something. He's like, pork tenderloin. And we're like, okay, it'll be ready in an hour. And it is like, you know, what you would pay like $50 for. So it's amazing.
Yeah, I love to keep some pork tenderloin around too. I'll jerk mine up.
Oh yeah.
Just you know, some Bahama Mamas and some jerk pork loin, chorizo fried rice.
Like all these different ways. He does ribs on it too, and we've had everything from like the mango habanero sauces to the more classic smoky sauces. I mean, we just do. We literally go wild with it now because it's like, okay, you can't really mess it up. Like you literally can't fuck this shit up. Like it tastes so good. So
yeah, you know, it's like I tell people with brining too. Once you brine a turkey, you can't fuck it up. You can, I mean, you'd have to just like leave the house for 10 hours and then come back. Right. And it may be a little dry.
Right. No, it's so true. People.
Yeah, and that's what I did. Yeah, I brined up a few breasts. I didn't do a whole bird because I know, you know, I don't know if a lot of listeners know that I cook for a lot of the elderly in my neighborhood too, you know, especially if they don't have family around. So, you know, it's like I've got myself and my family and, you know, cook for some neighbors. And a lot of my neighbors were actually going out of town to visit their family this year, which was great. That was like all of my dark meat eaters.
Oh, yeah.
So all my dark meat eaters left town. So I was like, hey, you know what? I'm just going to get like three or four breasts and ham and, you know, and then some more people, families showed up. So I was left with all of this extra turkey and ham. I don't know what I'm going to do with it all.
Oh, no. That's just the worst. See, actually, our nightmare is whenever every now and then this happens where because we've got like the family that does come to Thanksgiving, we always have stragglers too. Like, I mean, there's always like a friend that doesn't have a way, like can't be with family. So we're like, bring them along, you know. There's always, like you said, like a neighbor, like somebody like that. There's always like, could be an extra 5 to 10 miles at any given time. So there are these, and also some of our family, like they have to split their time between multiple families and grandmas and things like that. And so it's kind of come whenever, this is what time dinner served. And maybe that might be 2 or it might be 5, who knows. And then come, if you can be there for grace, great. If you can't, well, when you get here, there'll still be food and you can heat it up. And there have been a few years though, where because of that, like normally we make sure that we have enough leftovers. And like my aunt is known to like make mashed potatoes that like fit the bowl she wants to bring. And whenever those are gone, they're gone. So I always have to make a backup stash. Like I make a backup bowl about the same size because I know the men in my family would, and myself too. I can just eat mashed potatoes in a bowl by myself. But they, you know, so that we don't hurt her feelings, because people have tried to tell her multiple times, like, no, you need like double that. What are you thinking? There's like 25 people here. So in order to not hurt her feelings, we just keep like refilling her bowl. And it's just like, awesome. Whatever, I don't care. Nobody cares anymore. I was just like, and then someone will be like, oh, these are really, I season mine a whole lot more. I treat them like meat, like smoked meats really, or like any kind of grilled meats. It's like the sauce should make it better, but they should stand on their own. So I'm like, the gravy should make them better, but the mashed potatoes should have enough butter and salt and pepper to stand on their own. So every now and then someone will be like, oh, this part of the, oh, I got down in the bowl this time and it's really, ooh, really tasty. And we're like, those are different mashed potatoes. You know.
That's all. No, that's kind, and that's also awesome. That's hilarious.
It's really selfish though, because I want to make sure that I at least have some left over, but I also want to make sure everybody can have like 3 servings if they want.
Sure. Yeah, because I mean the one thing I always curse with, not just with the leftovers, but because everybody left, I've got more stuffed mushrooms than I know what to do with also. Cause I do a sausage stuff. It's really simple. It's just ground sausage and cream cheese, a little Parmesan cheese, and then stuff large cap mushrooms with them. And so I'm getting my fill of those as well.
I'm so sad for you. I know. I'll pray.
Yeah, you know, thoughts and prayers, people. Thoughts and prayers.
Yes, exactly. Well, speaking of like how things went on Thanksgiving, one of our traditions is to watch the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. And I'm not saying we sit down and watch it and like hang on everything, but it's sure. On in the background. You know, we start cooking and making pies and doing the things, and it's just on. And my family, being the musical family that most of y'all that have known me for a long time that we are, I very often know people performing in the parade, so we get to be excited when we're like, oh, you know, there's so and so and there's so and so, and this year was no different. And after a year off from the live true parade, it was cool to see it again. I performed in the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade years ago. My sister has performed in it. So it's kind of a part of our thing. Biden calls, FaceTimes Mr. Al Roker this year. You know, him and Dr. Biden, they call it Dr. Biden. They called into the show, and it was, you know, and it's like, okay, this is hokey, but of course, whatever. I mean, they wouldn't do it with Trump, but it doesn't surprise me that they're doing this, and it's not that big of a deal. I don't really care, but I'm watching it, and I was like, hey, President Biden and Dr. Biden, you know, how are you on this fine Thanksgiving Day, or whatever it is he said, and Biden's like, oh, yeah, happy Thanksgiving, Al, you know, da, da, da. And then he goes, oh, firefighter. and Al goes, and Al looks over his shoulder both ways. And he's like, oh, yeah, I got the firemen and the police. So anyways, blah, blah, blah. Y'all, I didn't see anybody comment on it. Everybody talked about how he called in for this message, and he said that it's better than ever. And after 2 years, which they haven't been in office 2 years, but okay, sir, 2 years, and they've already turned everything around and yada, 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 yada. And everybody commented on that. Nobody commented on his little sudden little spurty outburst.
And yeah, he went squirrel. I mean, he really.
Yes, did. It was that whole like slay-wise blue. Have y'all seen those? Y'all know those commercials, you know, about we're not going to act like our parents and whatever. It's like they have blue hair. We're not going to say anything. Blue. That was what it was like. He was like, oh, firefighter. What? I mean, I had to like, I was like, wait. And I did like a double take and then I rewound it and watched it again. And I was like, I would be like, I kind of laughed, but I was like, this is so sad. This is exactly the kind of thing that like so many elderly that I've known that have gone through various degrees of dementia, like that is so common. It's such a normal characteristic. And people can go, oh, he's kind of always been, yeah, he's always been a goofball, but he didn't always do those things. All right? Right. We've seen him in public for a really long time. But it was just this, it was, I normally don't like to like diagnose people from TV, but it was just so reminiscent. And the way he's like, hey, oh yeah, we're doing great here. No way. I'm a firefighter. It's like, oh, am I just like, say what I see. Anyways, right. Oh, man. Well, and I searched and searched. No one said a damn thing. And I was like, how did y'all miss this outburst?
Well, because they obviously fly cover. But I mean, it's, well, again, yeah. You know, talking about, you know, what would Trump, it's like the Thanksgiving tradition for the previous 4 years was to talk about how Trump was on a golf course and then be 180 to be completely wrong because he would be in a surprise visit in like Afghanistan serving Thanksgiving dinner to the troops or something, you know? Right. So it'd be like, you know, but, and this would be like, oh, well, we got it wrong. Moving along with the other Nazi bullshit. And it's like, okay. Here you have the president who you say everything is better and who really cares about the military, who is at home shouting fire, fire at Al Roker when he should be serving the troops like every other president has on Thanksgiving forever.
Right. I mean, remember Bush's was such a big deal because they had to go super secretive because of the dangers of war right. at the time, you know, for him to get to where he was. And it was like people really didn't know unless they were like they had to be on the flight. Yeah, I don't know. It was just weird. And, you know, of course, then Roker kind of spun it into, yeah, our public servants, oh, frontline workers or whatever. And it was like, no, it was like he seriously just saw a firefighter in the background. I was like, hey, there's a firefighter.
Like, well, you know, like, they do have that.
Like a toddler does when they pants. See a fire truck. Oh, yeah.
They've both pooped their pants. So, you know, they have that.
Oh, man, I still can't get over that.
I just, yeah. And again, something else completely downplayed by the media. Oh, hey, you know what they're talking about in England? About Biden farting in front of the Duchess. But, you know, that doesn't make it over here because that's a lie and everything.
Well, it's not even just, yeah, but even the ones that are like, do even admit it, they immediately go to that's not newsworthy though, and oh my gosh, oh so what, so he's human, oh this isn't something we should cover, and they have all these reasons why they shouldn't cover it, yet we've seen what they've done when people are on the opposite side of the political spectrum. I mean, all of it is newsworthy, all of it is something to be covered, to be chastised, to be shamed, you know, all the things.
These are the people who couldn't talk about anything else for 4 years but Bush throwing up on the Japanese prime minister,
right?
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. It, but, you know,
or
different.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. It's just the cover. Constant.
Sometimes I think how wonderful it must be to be a Democrat and not be held accountable for anything.
I know. But then you if you even like barely like you just try to search anything like that and you will just see millions of delusional souls that truly think that Democrats are always, everybody's so hard on the Democrat. Media is in the tank for Republicans. Republicans get away with everything. And everybody is so mean to the Democrats. Or they're so mean to them. And it's like, what fucking planet do you live on?
I mean, we just saw that over the last 24 hours with Amy Siskin, you know, going full cry bully. You're telling everybody to Brigade and Report Defiant L's, which is a Twitter account that posts blue checks contradicting themselves.
So, they literally posted screenshots of their tweets, things that they tweeted themselves, not made up stuff, not like memes, literally their tweets.
Not even out of context. It's like the full context is there. You know, it's not like it was part of a larger thread that they just took a snippet out. It was a one-off tweet that completely contradicts a previous one-off tweet. And yeah, so once they are embarrassed in any way, shape, or form, then they immediately call on the Twitter gods to, well, you know, anyway. Yeah, so she's a total crybaby.
But I love how she's like, she wants him reported. She wants that account reported for targeted harassment while targeting her harassment.
Right. But yeah, while calling on her 500,000 followers to target and brigade, that is the literal definition of targeted harassment. Right. According to Twitter TOS. And the other thing about it too is that her tweets would actually qualify, her previous tweet, the one that is highlighted in the Defiant L's tweet, would qualify as misinformation under the COVID guidelines. So
they just weren't doing that yet when it was, you know, the way it was leaning when Trump was still in office and they were going against Trump. It wasn't, you know, they weren't labeling it such yet. But yeah, it's actually that. And like someone in chat said, you know, they managed to increase Defiant L's follower count by a couple tens of thousands, you know.
Yeah.
Which was inevitable.
Doing the whole, it'll probably be my top tweet of the month, with my analytics, in that I tweeted was my entire timeline right now is people dragging Amy Siskind for being a cry bully, whatever it was I actually said. And
being a whiny little bitch.
Yeah, basically, it's like the last time I checked, it had near 1,000 likes. Well, that's going to be my top tweet of the month.
Yeah, 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 exactly. Well, and I mean, I had so many people that even on my tweet of it that were like, oh, great, thanks for pointing me in the direction of this account. It's hilarious. Like, you know, I kind of figured everyone that I follow and that follows me probably already knew about it, but apparently some didn't. And so they're like, oh, this is awesome. Great. I'm going to go. It's hilarious.
Yeah, no, and I was surprised at how few people actually knew about it. I mean, you'd think, because they had like 100,000 followers going into this thing, that, like you said, everybody in our,
I feel like it's kind of like in the Twitchy circle kind of deal, you know?
Yeah, he's a one-off Twitchy. He is. Yeah. You know, Twitchy's a whole article. He's just a meme.
Yeah, so like most of our followers are familiar with Twitchy. I assume you're familiar with Defiant. You know, there's just some accounts like that I just kind of assume. And then when I see people go, oh, fantastic, I'm like, pretty much every day my husband wakes up and like reads me like 3 of Defiant L's tweets and is like, oh, you gotta check out this one. Like, that's with the morning coffee, like, look at Defiant L's today, called out so and so.
Yeah, rather than sitting there reading the paper going, I should probably buy a boat, it's really, looking at the Defiant L's TL.
Yeah, he's like, what liberal did they roast today?
Yeah. But yeah, I was actually, like you said, I was actually surprised with how many people just kind of popped up and said, wow, I wasn't familiar with this account. That's fantastic. Thanks for turning me on to him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, so it didn't quite have the effect I think she thought it would. And, also the encouraging, not only the targeted harassment she brought to that account, but encouraging mass reporting is a violation as well.
Yeah, I mean, if she was a Republican, she would have lost her blue check by now. Will from News of the Week, he just posted in chat that they've gained 20,000.7 followers since yesterday.
Holy cow. Awesome.
Yeah.
Good for them.
Good for the, and it's things like that that going back to 2016 when, a lot of us were still kind of anti-Trump, it reminded me of when at the GOP convention that Real Donald Trump tweet got put on the board. So yeah, he was a parody account of Trump, and actually a pretty good, for as parodies go, he was a pretty good one. So they highlighted one of his tweets at the GOP convention on accident, and so that got him a lot of
Well, I've had a few times where some blue check thinks they're dragging me by responding and like quote tweeting me, and over the years, that yes, it's brought a crap ton of their trolls coming onto my feed, and I have to mute the tweet or whatever, but just so that I can even function on Twitter, otherwise it's just like what always ended up ultimately happening, yes, those people were annoying to deal with, but I would always see my follower count rise quite a bit during that time. So it's like, yeah, you think you're like burning me, but you're really building my account. Thank you, blue check.
Yeah,
thank
you're helping
very
my.
Much.
I mean, my experience with that was with Patrick Tomlinson. I don't know if you're familiar with him. He's a producer and a writer, a Hollywood writer and producer and everything. And I actually ruined his Italian vacation, fighting with me instead of spending time with his family in Italy. And it got me quite a few followers under the old Opulent Amish account. So that was fun.
Sally Cohn always gains me some. Though what I will say about her is she usually will like actually interact, and she doesn't name call and like do that kind of thing. But you know, she believes what she believes, and I don't agree with a lot of it, or hardly any of it. But she also will sometimes like joke around and just like silly spirits. Like I've sometimes commented on some of her non-political stuff, and I've like quote tweeting it like just being snarky or something, and she'll be snarky right back, and then it'll be like, blah, blah, actually I like this or I like that, and I always get a ton of interactions off those. But when we're nice to each other is when it's problematic, because I'll get followers from both sides, and then the half of them don't know what they're in for. And I'm like, whoops, sorry, you thought that like someone that you like from MSNBC was being jovial with me, so I must be a cool follow, and you're gonna not like what I tweet.
You might just want to unfollow, block me probably right now, because this isn't going to go the way you think it's gonna go.
Right, I'm just gonna go ahead and say that you probably don't have the ability to manage your Twitter and like ignore people the way that Sally does, because she's got, you know, a whole thing and a ton of followers, and who gives a shit if this one chick, like her followers come after her, like, and she's got a thicker skin than you probably have. So you with your 50, when you get offended by one of my, like, you probably just want to block me. I think you probably just want to go ahead and do that. Cause you know, then they're the first ones that if they respond to you and you respond back, like if they're mad at you about something you tweet and you respond back, and then people start responding, they're like, oh my gosh, you had to get all your followers to come at me. And I'm like, no, you commented on someone's tweets who has 15,000 followers. Just like right. I commented on Sally's tweets and she has 500,000 followers or a million followers or whatever she has. So of course I know, like, I'm going to get people commenting to me from her. Like, don't comment on someone's tweets that has any followers, really, if you don't want any of them to see it. DM them, I guess. I don't know. It always amazes me how people are surprised.
I go bartender on them. I say, you're a long way from home, son. Let me start you a tab.
The thing is I get it. Like, it gets annoying when people just, like, go after. I've had it happen to me, too. And I'm like, whoa. Wasn't talking to all you people. But I just ignore that. Other people get really, really offended. I'm just like, okay, they're bringing all their fanboys. I usually just don't consider it that the person is making them do it. I consider that it's their fans or their friends or their whoever. And I'm like, all right, the fanboys are out. I'm out. Mm-hmm. Peace. Because yeah. I don't have time for that. I ain't got time for that.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
No, not everybody defending someone is white knighting or wants to sleep with them, okay? I hate that shit, too.
She ain't gonna sleep with her, girl.
I mean, sometimes they do. And sometimes, and it's always a funny comment, but. But I just know I have, like, so many friends, so when they come on and they start saying stuff, and then the liberals like, oh, I guess you just have all these guys, or oh, you've got your little sausage brigade. I always get accused of that. I'm like, you don't even know the sex of half these people. Like, what are you talking about? Why are you misgendering people? You
know, isn't that bad? Isn't that, yeah.
I think I'll report you. I think you just misgendered, like, half the time, I don't even know what gender some of my followers are. It's very misleading sometimes.
That's why I just call everybody sport or kitten.
Right. Unless I get to know them, I'm like, all right.
So that first half went quick. Can you believe it? Did.
And what did we even talk about?
Oh, you know, stuff and things. And so anyway, we're going to go to a break real quick. And then when I come back, we're going to be talking more Twitter. But this time we're going to be talking about Jack Dorsey. He did some thing today. And other news. So refresh your drinks, smoke them if you got them, and we will be back in 3.
America. roll your hand in palaces. I love it when you smile. I love it when you sing, 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 sing. Holy Joe, that's your hand. Put some dollars down, you're wild. When it takes you by surprise, I'll be there to watch you. Run, 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 run. Close your eyes, but fire's out. To the memory of your home, where you go.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Spring will be here soon, so if buying a new home is on your to-do list, right now is the time to call Quicken Loans. Learn about which mortgage options make sense for you and get a jump on your competition. With our exclusive Rate Shield approval, the low rate you lock today is protected for up to 90 days while you shop for your new home. With a Rate Shield approval, if rates go up, your low rate stays locked. But if rates go down, you get that new, even lower rate. Either way, you win. Talk to us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com to take advantage. Here's another great reason to work with us. For a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Again, to lock in today's low mortgage interest rate and get the security of our exclusive Rate Shield approval, call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rate Shield approval only valid on certain 30-year fixed rate loans. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Hi, welcome to this Subway ad for the new Sesame Ginger Glazed Chicken Signature Wrap. How would you like it?
I'll take a...
Sports announcer at home?
Yeah, how'd you...
We just know.
My wife picks up the new signature wrap. It's got double the rotisserie-style chicken mixed with a sesame ginger glaze. She appears annoyed at me, but she shrugs it off. Those sweet and savory flavors are calling her name. She lifts the wrap and... She takes the bite! Incredible! And now she's closing the door on my... Subway, make it what you want.
Limited time only at participating restaurants. Double meat basement, average 6-inch sub.
I'm Little Teapot, short and stout.
Here is my handle and here is my spell.
No, Dad, like this. When I get all steamed up, then I shout, tip me over and
pour me out.
This is WWE superstar Roman Reigns. It only takes a moment to make a moment. Take time to be a dad today.
Visit fatherhood.gov, brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
We're back. Welcome back to Foo Bar, One Nation Under Foo. Foo is on hiatus for the remainder of the year. Tonight, I've got sitting second seat, Jen Holmstead. Jen, you come back from the break with us?
I did.
Nice. Yeah, we were talking about during the break, because she unplugged for most of the holidays, she didn't hear about the Salvation Army thing. So I was kind of bringing her up to speed because that's what they were talking about in our chat. And, without knowing the whole story, basically what it broke down to was they got a little bit of sock just, a little bit of CRT in their instructional manuals about, you know, get people to pray about their white supremacy. And they've come out and denied it since. But even then, I mean, the documents we all saw had the Salvation Army logo on it. And so it kind of like, if it's a fake, it's pretty damn good one. But what we were talking about during the break is, I mean, even aside, take everything else aside, the group of people who are more likely to drop cash in the kettle this time of year are going to lean to the right. And these are the people who vehemently reject CRT. So what did you think was going to happen when that got released?
Right. I mean, just this is just common sense. But of course, you know, like you were saying, you've got somebody that came in and told them, hey, here's what we need to do, because this is what all the companies are doing. And this is how we have to reach, you know, the Zennials and the Zoomers and the whatever. And this is the language that's got to be used and all of this crap, you know. And they went, okay, I guess that's what we do. And no, because if just even your basic logic, you would go, well, look at who are basic, like what the demographics are of our givers. Right. And just by sheer like population numbers in the United States of America, how that breakdown is on people that are of the age to be able to have anything charitable to give anyways. Just by numbers, you know, you've got not only the political leanings, but racially. So it's not even about who's better or who's more likely to give. It's number wise, what group is biggest? And yeah, I know they don't want it to be, but the group that's still biggest is the Caucasian-esque segment of the population. So I know they don't want it to be that way, but it is still. So, you know, it's just kind of, it's a little tone deaf.
The same people who are pushing this ideology are now like, you know, there's currently at this moment a hashtag trending on Twitter, white people overstepping. So it's kind of like, okay, so, you know, you, because of what happened in Virginia and other places, you are now attacking white women, white suburban moms, and they are pretty likely to drop in the kettle as well. So you are pandering to a group of people who are openly hostile to your givers, to your donors.
Well, not only that, but you're also pandering to a group of people that tend to be openly hostile to organizations like the Salvation Army that have religious base, that are a religious based organization. Yeah. So why are you even catering to them to begin with? Because they already think you're awful and corrupt, and that you push, you know, religion on people where they don't need it, and you should just help them without any of that involved, and you shouldn't have these requirements on them. You know, they're also against them because and I've hired a lot of people from the Salvation Army. So because there's one right in downtown near where I've worked, and they do. They have stricter requirements than most of the other shelters or places that, you know, people can possibly get a bed or get a meal. And they require you to keep your bed. You have to make a curfew, and you have to get, and there are a lot of people that protest that. There are a lot of people that think that that's wrong. So you're pandering to those people. They're not going to give to you anyways.
Yeah. And I mean, they, you know, they're the ones who are out there. I don't want to say canceling Christmas or attacking Christmas, but they're the ones who really don't celebrate, you know, the holiday anyway. So when they see your Santa ringing the bell in front of the red kettle, they're the ones who are going to walk right by, not even acknowledge if they're being nice about it, you know, right. Not openly hostile to the bell ringers either. So what amazed me is that this whole thing, I mean, this had to go up a chain. Yeah. This isn't just the kind of thing where, you know, some group within the Salvation Army said, okay, we're going to hold racial sensitivity training, you like an HR department and an essay or something, and then did this without any approval. You know, nobody else's eyes were on it going, wait a second.
I mean, there was nothing. Yeah, no one at any point was like, guys, I'm not sure this is our bag, y'all. I'm not sure this is our brand. Maybe tone it down a hot sec. Because from what now I'm kind of reading, I mean, it was pretty blatant. It's not like it was a shade of it. It was pretty blatant about what they were saying. So, how did that get missed? Yeah. How did that get missed?
I mean, you see this all the time, you know, when the brands are doing it again. And you wonder, did nobody in the company object at all?
Well, and I do think I have seen in just a couple things I've been a part of where stuff like this starts to happen a little bit. And part of the problem, what does happen there is people don't really feel like there's an opportunity to object because they're too low compared to people that are like, and then you've got the higher up people that are just rubber stamping it because they just want to be PC and deal with whatever, like, okay, sure, we're doing whatever we have to do. Okay, fine. And you don't have a lot of ability for kind of a middle ground there, a voice of reason that like both will listen to. So it just kind of gets shoved along until it's like too late. And then the people that wanted to say something, it's already in print and, you know, it's just, it's out the door, or they get shamed for even bringing anything up.
Yeah. Because it's the person, get the fear end of it too.
Yeah. The person that created that scheme, that marketing scheme, or that angle, the team that created that, I mean, you think the kind of thing they're creating, do you really believe that they're allowing for an environment that encourages any kind of dissent?
No. Yeah.
No.
As we talked through, I was thinking about it. I said, yeah, these are, you know, a team that would create that is the team who would go and put that person on blast for being an ist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for raising objections to a terrible idea.
Right. But I have known at least one organization where kind of what happened was they hired out for something like that to have more like sensitivity type stuff in their materials. And then it came back through. And what happened was is that the people that it came into the hands of didn't feel like they had the right to question it because they had been hired for this specific purpose and they were the experts. So like the people that got their hands on it, like didn't think to question it or think they could. And then they just passed it on to higher ups who thought it had already been looked at and approved. So they just rubber stamped it for the actual printing. So it's like, you know, there's just that disconnect of the circle that it goes through of like, which happens with a lot of shit, to be honest. But
yeah.
That's one of those things where like no one actually ever really had eyes on it to like take it from the person who, you know, created it and presented it to not like to having anything molded in between. It just went blah 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 blah, and then they went, oh shit, what are we doing? And you're like,
what have we done?
You know, like, didn't Katie get that? Didn't Ronnie see it? And you're like, no, well, I thought you saw it. Well, I thought you saw it. Well, you said, well, it got on my desk, so I said okay. Like, you know,
yeah.
Too late
I
by that point.
That. I hired the guy who approved that, but I
right.
didn't approve that. Yeah.
Right. Like, and the guy who was hired to approve it. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Why are we buying parachutes from Acme Supply?
Nice.
So, but okay. So we weren't even really engaged to talk, ready to talk about that. But one thing that you brought up, we need to talk about is Jack Dorsey is stepping down from Twitter. He has resigned.
Yeah, it's woo. That's a thing.
Yeah. And it, you know, it's the kind of thing that be careful what you wish for. In
right.
that everybody always said, yeah, this place would be so much better without Jack Dorsey. Then the guy they get. Now I don't take there was a tweet going around of his that a lot of people had offense, you know, took offense to. That one didn't bother me because when you went and saw the context of it, he was just quoting something from the Daily Show and he kind of agreed with it. It's like, you know, it wasn't saying what everybody's making out. You know, he was saying that, you know, if you are going to paint with broad brushes saying that all Muslims are terrorists, then all white people are Nazi. Yeah, that kind of thing where it's like you
right.
don't
paint. Right,
you
know, right.
It was the opposite of the context. But then he's also the one who he kind of rubber stamped the what we were talking about earlier with the putting warnings on tweets and things. You know, he said
right.
it doesn't matter if it's the truth or not. It matters what's, you know, what is for the best of our users, you know, what's safest for
right,
them.
Right. And he put together that ridiculous like board of people, like they called it a board, but it wasn't
the
like
trust
Twitter.
The safety
it
board.
Wasn't Twitter, but yes. And it was essentially like a ton of white people that were just, you know, woke AF. And
yeah, it's some of the names you'll recognize: Zoe Quinn, Anita Sarkeesian. I'm drawing a blank. Big Red. She Randy Harper. And Lou, you okay?
Hey.
Hey. So yeah, it was a lot of the big names in the anti-Gamergate movement, the third wave right. feminism, when this whole thing came about, the Twitter trust and safety brain trust.
Yes, which was just absolutely absurd because they basically were like, everything, anything anyone says that ever offends me gets to allow for me to have them booted off Twitter, and I get my safe space for just what I want my social media to be. And it's like, that's not Twitter.
Right.
Thankfully,
yeah, Brianna Wu was on it too, I think.
Yeah. They ended up walking some of it back, but that initial council and like the first kind of things they put out, it was like, whoa. It was going to de-boost white voices, you know, amplify small accounts that they thought were black or brown. Like, it was like all this crazy stuff. And it was like, you know, women, they wanted women to have the feature where like women only reply, but at the same time, like, we can't do genders. So I don't understand that. And then, you know, it's just like all these crazy things. And it was like, oh Lord, here we go. What a headache. But I do think you're right. There has, for as much as we all go, you know, F you, Jack, and all the kinds of things that he has allowed to develop on his platform, and it was his platform. I think that he also stayed out of a lot of stuff. He was not, you know, he was activist in the way he let his brand kind of develop and in the way that it continues to kind of mold and shift into this obviously very liberal leaning kind of thing, but he's also not been like some mouthy loud activist day in, day out, and I think you could end up with someone like that taking over the reins.
I mean at the end of the day, Twitter is a publicly traded company. They have a board of directors and they have to satisfy their investors. The problem with that is, and that all sounds great. The problem with that is that the majority of investors in Twitter are, you know, brokerage firms, trust fund, or not trust fund, but hedge funds and things like that. And they could not give a shit as long right. as it's turning a profit. And that was the one thing. As soon as Jack Dorsey announced he was stepping down, Twitter stock went up 20%.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all the hedge fund managers care about.
Right. Yeah. So it'll just be interesting to see what happens. I mean, I think they'd be wise to just pull someone in that's not going to be like, oh, and they're going to direct us into the progressive future. It should just be someone that can run a social media platform company. But we'll see how smart they are.
Yeah. And this is, you know, people wonder why Jack is stepping down, because he's got Square, which and he's also doing a which is Blue Sky, which is Twitter, but it's blockchain based. So that way tweets can't be deleted. And it's very, you know, even more, you know, open and, you know, free speech. But I mean, he got booed at the Bitcoin convention when he announced it. So, you know, everybody knew he was full of shit. But yeah, so I mean, Jack will be okay. Don't worry about Jack. But yeah, I do have concerns, but also being cautiously optimistic. Microsoft has gotten so much better since Bill Gates stepped down that, you know, hope springs eternal. If not, you can find me on Minds and MeWe as already Packard.
But yeah, it's, you know, things move on, people. I know people are really like, all my OU friends are really mad that the coach is leaving, but like, businesses are still businesses and people still have endeavors and they've got careers and futures, and like, things change and it makes people mad or it makes people happy, but that's how it goes. Mm-hmm. I didn't expect him to hold on. Usually with a company like this, especially, like, they don't stay on for 30, 40, 50 years. I mean, I don't know who expected that, but there were some that were bemoaning it. And I'm like, what? Why do you think Jack Dorsey was still going to be the CEO of Twitter? Like, we don't even know if Twitter, you know, I think it will be, but you don't even know if Twitter will be around in this capacity in 10 years.
Yeah, so where's, like, Tom at?
Right. Hey, Tom, how about the Facebook that's right. university email only? You know, I mean, legitimately, you say about Tom, it sounds funny, but legitimately in 2007, that was still like one of the main ways to communicate. It was still the bigger, it was the more all-inclusive social media platform, even though Facebook had grown a lot and was getting big, like in the late 2000, like before 2010. So we're just talking about not even 15 years ago. MySpace was still very real, very much a thing, and had cooler features and better features than Facebook. So
woe be on to you if you ever adjusted your top 20.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't mind. I stirred the pot all the time.
I'm not in your top 20 anymore.
I was like,
oh, fuck. I hate you. Drama.
Flavor of the week. Flavor of the week. No, there was a period of time there, though, where I rotated it constantly. And it was specifically because people, like, I don't know if you'll know this, but I can be kind of something. I don't know. Something. But, like, are you going to say anything? Are you going to say something? And just because nobody would do it. All the girls were so, and I'm like, oh, God, I hate girls. Or I did. Whatever. I don't know. I can't really get into all that. But at the time, teenage girls into early college girls, very stupid. Female breed at that time is not great. And so all my friends were guys anyways. But all the girls would get butthurt when they're not in my feed. And I'm like, I don't even like you. You don't even like me. Like, I don't even hang out with you. Why do you want to be one of my top friends? But
yeah, I would adjust mine just to feature like interesting people that you, like you said, flavor of the week. I'd move mine around just, but yeah, if you had like a real life friend that you moved out of your top 20.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oof. Yep. Yep.
Yeah. So damn, that's the show, girl.
Damn. Looky there.
Yeah.
Our posts, our turkey Thanksgiving hangover.
Our food coma.
I was so sad to have to like go back to real life today. It'd been pretty nice. Plus, this weekend was just like tons of awesome football, and
yeah, there was a lot of good games on.
Oh, such good football! It was so amazing, and I had the. Like here it was like overcast, it was like rainy one day, it was chilly, it was like just stay inside, watch football, recover, not have to put on clothes or go anywhere or do anything, and just eat leftovers. It was awesome.
I shared this, so I gotta share this. One of my favorite things with the leftovers is that I make homemade cranberry sauce.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll take half of what's left after the feast, and then I mix it with mayonnaise to use it as a spread on all my turkey sandwiches. And I'll put Perfect. That on one half, and then I'll put sweet potato casserole on the other half. That's my turkey sandwich, y'all.
Perfect.
Yeah.
We do all sorts of weird things, but what matters is, and I think everybody kind of has those little traditions, right, of little things that they do, but what matters is that you eat them. And it's like, unlike other leftovers throughout the year, well, you're like, you might eat half of it, you might not. Sometimes you clear out the leftovers. Sometimes they get moldy in the back of the fridge. Like, Thanksgiving leftovers get eaten.
Yeah, they get ate. They really do.
They get ate. They gone.
And one of my traditions is when I'm making space for everything that's going into the refrigerator, the soon-to-come leftovers after the meal, is that Thanksgiving morning, I make a frittata out of, like, you know, all the bacon and everything else that's going to be in the way. You know, Perfect. Anything that's been cooked, sausage or cheese, whatever, just to get, mm-hmm. you know, the last remnants is out of the way, because that's where the green bean casserole goes.
Right, right.
So I gotta get that dozen eggs out of there. So yeah, I'll do a big frittata and spread around the neighborhood too. So
Perfect.
Well, Dan, what you got going on this week?
Oh, not too much. We ended up picking up baseball season was over, but we picked up a tournament, but it's for a good cause. It's called the Grinch Tournament, and each division does a different kind of charity. So ours is a toy drive. So it's a toy drive for underprivileged families. That's our entry into the tournament, which is really cool. And it gets to be fun for the boys. They don't have to wear official uniforms, and we're probably going to do crazy like Santa and Grinch hats and just have a ball and not really care about winning or anything like that. And, you know, do good for charity. So kind of gearing up for that, and I'm going to be decorating for Christmas and, you know, generally trying to be in the spirit.
You guys got Misfits going on this week, and
I'm trying to figure out what all we're going to be doing this week. So I know everybody's had to like bear with us because I've been gone a lot on Fridays. My sister is about to have a baby, so I'm going to be back and forth from here in Nashville. So Rex and Dan have been holding down the fort quite a bit. I hope that I'm going to get to be on Friday night. I haven't checked with Dan about Wednesdays at all. So I don't know. Stay tuned. Probably everything's happening, but just stay tuned to the Twitter. We'll put it out there. So yeah, follow Misfits Politics and that'll have all your updates for you.
And if you weren't aware, Jen is also going to be one of the cast members in the KLRN production of A Christmas Carol.
Yes, I jokingly told the crew, but this might actually come into the play. I'm going to be daughter, the Cratchit daughter that is the sex worker, Martha.
Nice.
Well, she's late for dinner and mom's all like worried. And she says, yeah, you know, I got to put them up and I got to stay late. And like, what can you do?
That's us. It's gonna be. It's gonna be so
skirts,
much fun.
You know, I gotta. What am I gonna do about my skirts? I gotta get them changed, Ma.
Maria, the sex worker. Goes with the whole Twitter brothel thing too.
Exactly. Oh my gosh, I didn't even think about that. Yes, it's Martha, Maria, Jen, the Twitter brothel, Madame. Right. Obviously, I haven't decided what voice she's going to have yet, so I keep changing it. We'll see.
Yeah,
maybe I'll have by then.
I've been playing with my Scrooge voice too, figuring out if I want to do it like Buddy Hackett and Scrooged, or if I want to do it, you know, like John Houseman. I've been playing around with a lot of different voices.
Nice.
Yeah. So awesome! Thank you so much for filling in for Foo tonight.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me as always. Always a blast.
Yeah, and everybody, we will be back in about 10 minutes with Cyber Chill. Lou and I are going to break down all the tech news you need to know for the week, and probably some of it you didn't need to know, but are going to learn anyway. And then, as always, you can find me on Twitter as That Amish One. Mine's and MeWe is Already Packard. Have a great night, everyone, if you're not sticking around. And if you are, we'll see you in about 10.